As easy as shelling peas. Well, that's how the saying goes, but is growing snow peas really that easy? G'day, I'm Mark from Self Sufficient Me. Well, growing snow peas can be pretty easy if you follow my five top tips on how to grow a ton of snow peas. Let's snap into it. Speaking about shelling peas, you technically don't grow snow peas to shell, but you can. More about that intriguing point later. That was pretty easy. Snow peas are usually grown to eat whole and are remarkably similar to sugar snap peas. In fact, sugar snap peas are a cross between these snow peas and regular peas, and that is the bee's knees. Tip number one, soil preparation and sowing. Soil preparation is one of the big keys to growing a good crop of peas. I prepared this bed with some more soil, compost, and animal manures to make the soil structure free draining enough, but also water holding and rich. Peas are fairly resistant to dry conditions, but they still do best with regular water. And whilst they can handle sandy or heavy soils, you'll get better results if the soil is Goldilocks. Not too heavy, not too light, but just right. Peas are best sown where they are to grow. In other words, you're best just sowing them straight into the prepared garden bed. Root disturbance is always a thing when you're transplanting vegetables, and if they can establish their own root system right from the get-go, all over, they grow better. Sow the seeds close together, about an inch or two apart max, to allow for a loss of crop from insects or rodents gnawing them off, because even if half make it, you'll still have a good crop. But if they all make it, and that's what's happened here, well then all the better, because they don't mind growing close together, and the more you get in there, the bigger harvest you're going to get. Don't overwater at the start, but then start watering regularly once the peas have germinated. This is a lush crop, and you don't want to stress the plants out through underwatering, because all that will happen is the plants won't grow as well for a start, but the actual fruit or the pods themselves won't be as crunchy and tasty to eat. On the other hand, you don't want to overwater either, otherwise you could rot the roots. It's easy to know if your snow peas need a little water because the foliage will start to wilt, especially in the heat of the day. So if you notice any slight wilting, the crop probably needs water. But the best way is the old finger test. I've done this many times in lots of videos where you stick the finger into the soil at about the second knuckle. And if it comes up totally dry, well then you know that the plants need a bit of a drink. Try to water pea plants at the base, and this will help to limit the spread of fungal diseases that like a moist environment or rely on spores spreading through water droplets. This variety of snow pea is called an Oregon dwarf, not because of the size of the pods, but because of the size of the vine. It can get between 1 to 1.5 meters tall, whereas other types of snow pea varieties can get up to 2 meters. This particular variety is well suited to our raised tunnel trellis, and also because we're growing some other plants in the middle here, they still have an opportunity to catch the morning and afternoon sun as it passes over. Tip number two, where and when to grow. I reckon a trellis like this is the perfect place for snow peas to grow. Not only can you get access to both sides for easy pod picking, but this type of structure, being a strong metallic frame, allows the peas to secure themselves, weave in and out, and attach to the trellis with their tendrils. Also, growing snow peas this way allows for better aeration or airflow through the vines, and this helps to limit the humidity and moisture buildup, which in turn dramatically reduces common leaf diseases such as powdery mildew. Peas are fickle plants and are susceptible to wind damage, especially at this time of year here in our winter time when we get lots of windy and gusty days. Growing them on a strong trellis like this is helpful, but I also like to use some twine and secure the plants flush against the trellis, and what this does is prevents any strong wind or gusts from bending the plants over and causing crop damage. Peas grow quite well in pots too, if space is a problem, like on a balcony. Snow peas hate the heat and humidity. Some people say the name snow peas was derived from the fact that it can withstand some light snow and frost, making them a good early crop to grow in cooler climates before it gets too hot. Then in autumn, as the humidity and heat fades, you can possibly get another crop in before winter hits. In warmer climates like mine, and the sun has just come out appropriately, we like to sow in mid to late autumn. And that's because the heat and humidity has somewhat dissipated. Then we can sow all winter, timing the last crop to mature at about mid-spring when it starts to get too hot and humid for them again. Tip number three, nutrition and fertilizer. People often have the misconception that because peas can manufacture their own nitrogen, they can be grown in fairly poor soils without a problem. This is not true at all. Peas love a good quality medium with lots of nutrients gained through organic matter like manures, composts, and mulches. Yes, it is true that snow peas make their own nitrogen fertilizer practically out of thin air, which is pretty unbelievable. And growing snow peas with leafy greens, like this beetroot here and the celerac in the middle, is beneficial for these crops because what happens is the peas use a bacteria that helps it to fix nitrogen into the soil at the root zone, which these plants can then access. So not only can the peas help a successive crop that is grown in the same bed after them, but they can also even feed plants that are intercropped at the same time. And the last point about nutrition is feeding pea plants throughout the growing season, say a mid-season feed as you would with other crops, isn't usually necessary, especially if you've prepared the bed properly in the first place. Tip number four. Pests and disease. Now, I've already mentioned quite a few tips and points on pest and disease in this video, but here are just a few more to note. Try not to spray peas ever and at all if you can help it, because you can see here it's flowering and it's got fruit, and this is perpetual. It just keeps on producing. So there's no real window of opportunity where you can spray and then not hurt bees and other pollinating or good insects. The benefits you think you get out of regular spraying as a preventative are nowhere near the damage that it causes to the ecosystem and your plants in the long term. Peas will naturally die back towards the end of life, so don't be concerned if your flourishing and producing plants begin to wither with leaf diseases towards the end of the season or after the peak of pea pod production, because that's normal. And that's a lot of peas in a row. But seriously, you shouldn't really need to use a fungicide. And if you believe you've done everything right and the healthy plants are getting hit prematurely with fungal diseases, try the old milk mixed with water remedy first. Half water, half milk, mix them together, spray them on the plants, and that usually helps against fungal diseases like powdery mildew. Having said that, there are viruses that can usually be spread by insects such as aphids that can quickly decimate a pea crop. So if you find your crop suddenly dying back literally within days, then it might be prudent to cut your losses, rip them out, and start again, especially if it's early in the season. And I would advise to keep an eye out for aphids, because aphids are one of the key insects that spread those viruses, and they will target the new young shoots of pea plants. So if you see them, spray them with a bee-friendly pest oil at a time when the bees aren't flying around, and you should be able to get on top of them quick smart. Tip number five, harvesting. How long to harvest? Well, we started harvesting our first pods at around the 9-week mark, but they've started pumping now at the 11th week mark, full of pods as you can see, and also heaps of flowers. So let's get into harvesting this crop and see how many we can get. I've got my bowl and my scissors. And the reason why I like using a scissors is because what you can do is you just cut it off at the flower end there, and it's nice and easy, rather than pulling on the vine, because what that can do is damage those fickle stems, and you don't want to do that, because you can see there's plenty more flowers and more smaller ones to come after this. Well, that's one side nearly done. Got the whole inside to go yet, and it looks like I'm going to need another bowl. Crikey, that took a lot longer than I expected, and I'm sure I've missed quite a few. Here's two here. Wow. What a pee haul. Here's the thumbnail there. Few more points on harvesting. Harvest regularly to produce more flowers and fruit. I expect we should get several more big harvests out of our crop yet over the coming weeks. Leave some to mature. Yes, snow peas are best eaten immature and as a pod, because if you leave them mature, they get stringy and not as nice to eat. However, the peas inside certainly are good eating, so shelling them like regular peas is totally fine to do. And although a packet of snow peas isn't going to break the bank, you can let your crop mature totally, dry out, and get those pods and reuse those seeds for sowing next season. And speaking of weight and peas and packets and price, something like this, I'm guessing, because my arm is getting sore and I'm a fairly big fella, I reckon this weighs about probably two kgs, maybe 2.5. At the going rate, at about $26 a kilo for snow peas, you get what I'm saying. I've well and truly got back my $3 packet of seeds, and that's just one harvest. That's what I'm talking about. Snow peas in the pods don't keep very well. They will last a few weeks in the crisper, no problems at all. Nice cold crisper, eat them there, they'll keep the nutrition, they'll keep their crunch, and they'll slowly get a bit rubbery and no good. You can blanch them also in boiling hot water for a few minutes and then freeze them individually before packing them away. They'll last a couple of months in the freezer, but they still won't be as nice as eating fresh like this. There is one other way that is the best way, I reckon, to preserve them, and that is through lacto-fermentation. What you can do is you can ferment them in a brine on their own like this, or you can mix them in with other types of vegetables like broccoli, kale, cabbage, and make like a mixed fermented sauerkraut type of thing out of them. But the beauty of lacto-fermentation means it doesn't just preserve them, preserve the crunch, preserve the nutrition. It actually enhances the nutrition by inoculating it with those lactobacilli bacteria, which is so good for our body, in particular our stomachs. So that's why I love fermenting them, and that is my preferred way to preserve snow peas. Well, I hope you enjoyed my 5 top tips on how to grow a ton of snow peas. If you did, make sure you give it a big green pod snow peas thumbs up and share the video around. Subscribe if you haven't already. If you've got any questions or comments, whack them down in the comments section below so that we can all read them and learn from them as our YouTube gardening community grows. Thanks a lot for watching. Bye for now. Oh. Now that's some crunch. Wow. I could just about eat all these.